Hi everyone, my name is Nicolas Lanchier, I'm a mathematics professor. This video is the first one of a playlist I'm putting together on the topic of discrete-time Markov chain. So in this first video, to get started, we are going to talk about the following topics. So first, of course, I'm going to start by giving you a rigorous definition of the notion of Markov chain. Then we'll see what's the real meaning of the definition, like the intuition behind the definition, and we'll see that this implies that discrete-time Markov chain can be described completely by what they call their transition probabilities. Then we'll see that you can use those transition probabilities to define two important objects. The first one is called the transition matrix, the other one I'm going to call it the directed graph representation of the Markov chain, and we'll see how those two objects can be used in practice. Then we'll talk about some extension of the notion of transition probability called multi-step transition probabilities. Then I will talk about Chapman-Kolmogorov equation that shows how those multi-step transition probabilities are connected to each other. And finally, I will prove one theorem showing how to compute those multi-step transition probabilities using Chapman-Kolmogorov equations and the transition matrix. So first, what is a Markov chain? Let's start with the definition. So a discrete-time Markov chain is going to be a discrete-time stochastic process. So that's a sequence, let's call it Xn, of random variables. Okay, there are all those random variables are defined on the same probability space that we call omega fp. And this is a discrete-time Markov chain. With a state space that we are going to assume to be finite or countable, so with a finite state space S, if we have the following weird equation. So if basically the probability that xn plus 1 is in a set, let's say B, given fn, so fn is basically the filtration of the process xn, the natural filtration of the process xn. So if this is equal to the probability that xn is, xn plus 1 is in B, so same event as here, but given only xn. And you want this to be true for all set subset B of S. So I'm going to write this here. For all B subset of S, we should have this. So what does it mean exactly? Well, if you know about measure theory and stochastic processes already, you recognize that Fn is the natural filtration of the process Xn. If you don't know about this notion of natural filtration, just have in mind that Fn is basically so that's the sigma algebra generated by x0, x1, up to xn. So this object, this mathematical object, called a sigma algebra, represents in fact the past of the process. The past including the present if we think of time n as the present. So what this means is that the probability of an event happening in the future, in the next time step in the future, that I recall xn plus 1 belongs to B. So if you know the past, including the present, then to make prediction about this event, in fact, you only need to know the present. So this is what it means, okay? Given the past, including the present, probabilities of events in the future only depends on the present. So this means basically that Markov chain implies memoryless. That's kind of the good way to think about it. And let's draw a little picture to show you what this means. So for instance, let's assume that this is time. Okay, so we, in this case, we are in discrete time. So we have, let's say, time 0 here and 1 2, and so on. And let's add a vertical axis here that would represent S, the state space. So, for instance, your process can start from a state here, then jumps here, then here, and so on. And let's assume that you are able to observe the process at time 0, 1, 2, and this is the present time, and you want to make prediction on the future. So let's assume, for instance, that you have a state here, and you want to look at the probability that indeed we are going to jump to this state. So to compute the probability that the process is in this state at time 3, given that you know all the past, so you are able to observe all the past, the definition means that you can ignore the initial state and you can ignore the state at time 1. The only thing that matters is where the process is at time 2. So this is exactly what this definition means. So again, this means memoryless. You can forget the past. You can only, if you know where you are right now, it's enough to make predictions on the future. So now, a consequence of this definition, you've seen the picture, is that to be able to completely, to fully describe the process, the only thing you really need to know is the probability of going from a state to another one in only one time step. And we are going to assume that this does not depend on the time, so that's what we call a time homogeneous Markov chain. It means that the evolution rules of the process do not depend on time. Okay, so then this brings me to another definition, which is also kind of a properly a direct consequence of the definition of Markov chain, that says that the process is fully characterized by what we call its transition probabilities. So that's the first important notion we are seeing here, by its transition probabilities. And those transition probabilities are basically defined as the probability that the process goes from a state to another one, so let's say from x to y in one time step. So we call those p, x, y. By definition, this is the probability that the process at time n plus 1 is in state y, given that at the previous time step, it was in state x. And you can define those quantities for all x and y in the state space. Because we assume that the state space is I said finite, but we can extend that to, in fact, countable. So, because the state space is finite or countable, it's enough to know those transitions, okay? And so, if you know all this, then you have some characterization of the process. So, that's the first important notion. And you see again that the quantity on the right a priori depends on n. I'm using n here, but the quantity on the left does not depend on n. This is to reflect the fact that we are dealing with some time homogeneous Markov chains, meaning that again, this probability of going from x to y is always the same across time. So then from this definition, you can build two important objects. So the first one is called the transition matrix. So the transition matrix is basically a square matrix where basically number of rows and number of columns are equal to the number of states. So if you deal with some infinite countable state space, then your matrix is going to be infinite, but that's okay. Then if you have n states, let's say, or I should not use n because it's already used here, but let's say if you have k different states, then your transition matrix is going to be a k by k matrix. And this matrix is defined by basically, we call it P, capital P, like the probability, but in the context depending on the context, we clearly see that this capital P can be a probability, and in other contexts, we are talking about the transition matrix. And so the matrix is defined looking at all its coefficients. So we basically assume that the coefficient xy of the matrix P is equal to the transition probability Pxy. So in fact, what we can write more simply is just that P is equal to the collection of the P xy for x and y in S. Okay, so the idea is really to put all those transition probabilities, instead of having a bunch of numbers with no specific order, the idea is just to put them in a matrix, and it turns out that just this representation in terms of transition matrix is very useful in practice. So now, second type of representation of a Markov chain is to use a directed graph. So what is a directed graph? Well, basically a graph is a bunch of points that we call vertices. And those points can be, or vertices can be connected by edges. Directed means that there is a direction along the edges, so we, in which case we use instead the word arrow. So a directed graph is basically a bunch of vertices, and some of those vertices are connected by arrows. So in this case, we are going to assume that the set of vertices is given by the set of states. So I'm going to write V equals S, okay? Meaning that, again, you have a bunch of points corresponding to the state of the process, and we are going to put an arrow from X to Y. So X and Y are two states or vertices, and we are going to draw an arrow from X to Y if and only if the transition probability Pxy is strictly positive. So now you see that in looking at those two definitions, you see that the transition matrix has much more information than the directed graph. Okay, the transition matrix knows where what are the values of all the Pxy. While in the directed graph representation, we only look at whether the Pxy are equal to zero or strictly positive. So it seems that the directed graph representation is not as good as the transition matrix. In fact, the second representation is in fact much more useful than the transition matrix if you want to study qualitative aspects of the process. They are much easier to visualize. So the first conclusion I want to say here, but we'll understand that better after, is the fact that the transition matrix in concrete, looking at concrete examples, or it turns out that the transition matrix is going to be much more useful to be able, I mean, if we want to compute things, so the transition matrix is better to study quantitative aspects of the process. So in particular, by quantitative aspect, I think of multi-step transition probabilities that I'm going to define soon, or the stationary distribution of the process. At the opposite, the directed graph representation does a much better job than the transition matrix to study qualitative aspects. So just have in mind, transition matrix is good for quantitative aspect, directed graph is better for qualitative aspect, and by qualitative aspect of the Markov chain, here I mean things like finding the communication classes of the process or finding the period of the process, which I'm going to define in other videos. So now, next step is to define an extension of this notion of transition probabilities that we call multi-step transition probabilities, and basically this means that instead we look at the probability of going from x to y in n time steps. So I'm going to define this right now. So definition what we call multi-step transition probabilities. To be more precise, we can call that n-step transition probabilities. And this is defined as the probability of going from state X to state Y in n units of time. So we write those Pn X Y, and by definition, they are equal to the probability that the process Xn is in state Y at time n, given that we start from state X. Again, you can define that for all X and Y, which are two different states of the process. So now, why this notion of n-step transition probabilities is kind of an interesting object in practice? Well, let's assume, for instance, that you can find a Markov chain that would describe, let's say, the weather or the stock market. And you know basically the probability that the weather is going to be this or the stock market is going to be that tomorrow based on what you know today. But then what you might want to look at instead of what's going to happen tomorrow is, well, what is the probability that we will see this or that a week from now or a month from now? So that's why those transition probabilities are useful in practice. I mean, they are kind of relevant objects. So now, to conclude this video, the goal is basically to show you that, in fact, those n-step transition probabilities are, at least in theory, easy to compute using the transition matrix. But for that, I need to first show you a little formula called Chapman-Kolmogorov equations. So Chapman-Kolmogorov equations are useful here, but I'm going to use them again multiple times in other videos. That's very a nice tool that we can use in the context of discrete-time Markov chain. So Chapman-Kolmogorov equations. So they basically allow you to look at, compute, to find a relationship between Pn plus m, let's say, xy. So that's the probability of going from state x to state y in n plus m steps, but just using the Pn xy and the Pm xy. So the way it goes is like this. You just write that by definition, this is the probability of being in state y at time n plus m, given that the process starts in state x. Then you are going to use the conditioning to cut this into two parts and basically say, well, going from x to y in n plus m time step means that you go from x to z in a certain number of time step, and then from z to back to y in the complement, basically. So an equation that gives you sum over all the possible state z of the probability that x n plus m equals y, given that xn equals z, okay, times the probability that xn equals z, given that x0 equals y. So now remember that we assume that the process is time homogeneous, which means that the probability of going from z to y in from time n to time n plus m, in fact, does not depend on n, that only depends on m. So this quantity is just going to be equal to the m-step transition probabilities, and so to go from z to y. So this is a pmzy. This one is a pnxz. So rewriting this, we obtain that this is the sum for all z in S of Pn xz times Pm zy. So the fact that this is equal to that, that's what we call Chapman-Kolmogorov equations. Okay, and so you see basically that this tells you that to look at the to know the probability of going from one state to another one in n plus m states, you can basically break it down, and if you know the n step and m step transition probabilities, then you can easily deduce this one. So again, this is something that doesn't look very useful just the way it is here, but in fact it's very useful to prove a bunch of theorem. That's one of our main tools. So I'm going to rewrite that and rewrite this equation at the top so that after we can prove the main theorem of this video. Okay, so I rewrote this equation at the top, and now from this result we can deduce a first very useful result in practice. And so this theorem says basically that Pn xy, so meaning again the probability of going from x to y in n time step, is in fact equal to just Pn xy. But this case, I'm looking at capital P, the transition matrix, that, and I look at the nth power of this matrix, and I'm looking at the coefficient xy of the of this matrix. So, in fact, computing this type of this type of transition probabilities, like multi-step transition probabilities, can be tricky because you have to look at all the possible trajectory of the process going from x to y. Now it turns out that this would involve a lot of conditioning, and this can be kind of tricky. Now it turns out that the structure of matrix already takes care of that, so that's kind of a nice thing. Just looking at the nth power of the matrix automatically gives you the correct coefficient, the coefficient you are looking for. So how do we prove that? It's not very difficult, in fact. So the proof is like that. So you just prove the result by induction. On n. So it turns out that the result is clearly true for n equals 1. I'm going to tell you why. It's basically by definition. So true for n equals 1. So why is that? Well, because P1xy is just the one time step transition probability, so that's what we call the transition probability, and P at the power 1 is just P, so the result for n equals 1 just tells you that the matrix, the coefficient of the matrix P should be the transition probabilities. Well, then, yes, it's true by definition of the transition matrix. So notice also that something interesting is that, in fact, the result is also true for n equals 0. So I'm going to say that it's true for n equals 0 and 1. And in those two cases, that's kind of obvious. So what happens when you take n equals 0? Well, then on the left-hand side, that's exactly the probability of being in state y given that you're in state x at the same time, okay? P0xy is probability of being in state y given that you are in state x. Clearly, this quantity is equal to 0 if x and y are different, but 1 if x and y are equal. So this means that what we want to have here is basically the identity matrix, the matrix with only 1s on the diagonal and 0 off diagonal. And indeed, by convention, it's the case. A matrix at the power 0 is indeed equal to the identity matrix. Okay, so the result is indeed true for n equals 0 and 1. Now, how can we prove the result at step n plus 1? if we assume that it's true at step n, so following induction, I'm going to assume that this theorem is true, not for all n, but for a particular n, and I'm going to show you, using Chapman-Kolmogorov equations here, that indeed we can deduce that the result should be true also at step at time n plus 1. So for that, you just write that Pn plus 1 xy. So this is equal, according to Chapman-Kolmogorov equations applied for m equals 1. You see, it's the same thing, but taking n equals 1 here, I'm able to write that this is equal to the sum for z in S of Pn xz times P1, which is just Pzy. Okay? Now, because we assume that the result is true at time n, I can replace Pn by the nth power of the matrix, same here. And so eventually we get the sum for z in S of p at the power n xz times capital P z y. And then the last step is just to remember basics about linear algebra, and here it's just a product of two matrices. If you look carefully at this term, what we are doing basically is looking at, so z moves along the across the state space, so those coefficients are exactly the coefficients on row I on row x of the matrix Pn. Then here again, z is the first coordinate moves, but the second one is fixed, it's y, and so now we are looking at all the coefficients on column y of the matrix P. So what you are doing is looking at basically the scalar product of row x of the matrix Pn with column y of the matrix P. So the coefficient you should obtain is exactly the coefficient xy of the product of the two matrices. Now clearly the product of the two matrices is Pn plus 1. Okay, so this is Pn plus 1. And indeed you look at row x column y. So this is again x, y here. And so we were able to prove that indeed, if we assume that this is true at time n, then using Chapman-Kolmogorov equations, we are able to prove that this is true at step n plus 1. Here you see I'm just using some basic linear algebra, like matrix algebra, product of matrices. And that's it for this video. In future videos, in the few next videos, I'm going to give you examples of application, like examples of Markov chain, and we'll see how to compute the transition probabilities or the n-step transition probabilities in practice. Now, notice that even if this result looks very useful, and in fact, that's going to be very useful to prove various theorems in the field of Markov chain, it can be tricky to use this in practice. Well, why is that? Well, it's because if your matrix is not a 2x2 matrix, but it's just a little bit bigger than that, and if n is not very small, let's say you look at a 5x5 matrix at the power 10, then you struggle with the product of matrices. So this can be very consuming in terms of calculation, like computationally, but at least that gives you some very nice theoretical formula that we use a lot to prove theorems about Markov chain. And we'll see after that using this we can have some shortcuts to, for instance, compute the stationary distortion without having to compute all those nth power of matrices. So that concludes this video. See you next time with examples of application of that.